first introduce our distinguished guest who's joining us here today, Mr. Alfonso Lozano Basanta. Mr. Alfonso Lozano Basanta is the current coordinator of the Emergency Response Coordination Center, or ERCC, in the European Commission. Mr. Lozano Basanta serves as program officer in the development of the European Civil Protection Pool, or ECPP, and as deputy team leader of the ERCC operations. In this capacity, Mr. Lozano Basanta is at the forefront of international emergency response coordination. In addition, Mr. Lozano Basanta has experience working in international emergency relief settings outside of Europe as a humanitarian worker. He is also the author of groundbreaking works such as Disaster Risk Contribution to Peace Building Programs. So today here, we've recorded four segments from our 1 hour long interview that took place in November 2021 that we're here sharing with you today. So thank you very much for listening in, and we hope you enjoyed these sections here. Speak a bit on maybe with your own personal field work, for example, have you seen any concern or maybe political sensitivities arising when you have these militaries involved in these types of civil protection or emergency response operations?
Concerns from the humanitarian aid perspective is definitely sometimes that the independence of the operation on the resource could be put in danger sometimes because of the engagement of the military. Also sometimes it's not always accepted to send, let's say, military planes to a country that is affected by the disaster. They need to give the permission and the landing permits actually for that plane. And might be that if it is a military plane, there will not be this permission. So those are sometimes a couple of experiences. The question of independence and neutrality, I know that sometimes this is one of these issues that might be controversial, no? When you don't have a counterpart that speaks the same language and can create this type of coordination between the civilian and the military. But it's true that even if might not be a concrete situation where that could be the case, that is being detrimental for the neutrality and independence of the response, just the perception is already affecting the response and the perception of the teams. So that's something important. Maybe within the civil protection is a bit less, let's say, relevant in the sense of affecting the response. But still, it's true that sometimes it could be good also to have certain type of capabilities within the civilian and not only to have them in the military sphere. And if we could be complement and use only for the last resort, as is the idea principle, the military, I think will be always beneficial. That is well respected. I think sometimes also from the military, they feel obliged and they are perhaps also encouraged to intervene in certain type of disasters because they also need to have a role there. And that role many times is engaging with the humanitarian response. So I can understand and you can imagine how difficult it might be for them sometimes not to be involved in that. And that's why it's important to find this common understanding and common language between the two different groups.
I would love to hear more if you were involved in the COVID-19 pandemic response. And if you were, can you speak on whether you had any experience there working with militaries, military personnel, or other resources?
Yeah, so we have different. I mean, we have been very involved, and we are still very involved in the response to COVID, actually. And we had, yes, different experiences where military were also participating or acting and doing operations. So we have, for instance, from our perspective, from the ERCC perspective, the European Response Coordination Center in DG ECHO, weekly coordination with NATO, just to make sure that we were both informed of the different operations and not duplicating in this case. We had also a request for assistance from UN OCHA and WFP for strategic airlift to deliver cargo, the assistance at the moment when all the commercial flights were closed or canceled because most of the airlines were grounded. And there was a need to still activate and move humanitarian cargo and humanitarian personnel to different countries to the operations. And for that, we received this request for assistance for civil military coordination and strategic airlift. And we were also collaborating in that regard with them and finding a solution. And at that moment, the procedures that we have within the European Union, together with the external action service and the military staff, were activated. So we were in very close collaboration with the military staff from member states to make sure that we could respond to jointly to these requests from UN. And then there is the other type of intervention from the military that has been transporting cargo from member states. So there has been need to, of course, intervening at national level, which in that case we have not been involved directly, but monitoring from our dimension. And but in some cases when there was a need to transport, even to transfer patients recently from one country to another to be treated in hospitals when the health system is overwhelmed, some of them were transported with military planes as well. So these are three concrete examples on how they were involved during COVID.
Talking about your coordination with OCHA and NATO, I'm really curious to ask now, do you find that there is an existent hierarchy among different international coordination response mechanisms? For example, in terms of an overall framework, convening power, operational authority, or does it work more separately in different domains?
There is, for those meetings, as I mentioned before, there is a civil military focal point in DG ECHO who is attending those regular meetings together with UN OCHA and the different partners that are engaged in civil military operations. And one of them, of course, is NATO, but also there are other military representatives from member states also participating. So those coordination meetings, I think they are held in regular basis and that facilitates that coordination. When it comes to an emergency, then we have them ad hoc. And in those ones, from our side, we might expand the participation. Of course, our focal point is always present, but if there is a need to bring on board somebody from our side, from the ERCC, the European Response Coordination Center, then probably we'll also add it to these conversations. And of course, you have the more bilateral, sometimes coordination as well, outside these meetings.
Do you think that the military assets should be more normalized and streamlined into disaster management? And if so, what do you think needs to be the next steps?
Can you repeat the question? Because now there was a bit of noise.
And you know what? I have construction here as well. The last question for us today is that, do you think the use of military assets should be more normalized and streamlined into disaster management?
Yes. If I understood correctly, because I'm not sure if I catch the whole question, is that how to normalize the use of military capabilities within disaster response, more or less, yeah?
Yes, and if you agree with that, if that should be the way forward, yes.
Well, I have to say that I have the view from the civilian perspective. So I would say that we need to reinforce more the civilian than the military. I think if there is a possibility to invest in the military, it should be the possibility also to invest in developing capabilities within the civilian. Because in the end, as we said before, these difficulties sometimes for getting access for the military in natural disasters, I don't think it will disappear in the future. But on the contrary, if there is still more tension on the international level, it may be the contrary, that there is less acceptance when we are talking about natural disasters. So I would say that it's important also to reinforce and to develop capacities within the civilian sphere.
So thank you kindly, Mr. Lozano Basanta, for your time today. We really appreciate your contribution and your time to our project. And so for those listening in to our interview, if you want to hear more regarding our FOGS M4CE project or Militaries for Civilian Emergencies, please continue to follow us on our social media pages. And more so, we really hope you'll join us on Tuesday, November 23rd for our online panel, which will bring together these experts and more to continue this cutting edge topic. Thank you.